I'm at Freetown. And I'm sorry if you guys didn't see me earlier. I just landed today. Not in Singapore, in this conference. So I'm from Pivotal. We do get databases, and most of them are open source now. So just give you an insight of how we actually worked around with Postgres and Hadoop. Why we did that, what are the takeaways that we could, we got, and what are the takeaways that the community should take a look at. Just give you a quick overview of what happened to this.
Sorry, just give me a minute.
That's fine. Oh, it's fine. Yeah. Oh, it's fine again.
But they just died.
That's fine.
Going in and out. Let's
have a
look. One minute.
Can you stay a little on? Is it okay? You move your slides now? You're not even?
Yes, I can.
Okay, it should be good.
It should be fine now.
Should be fine, I guess, yeah.
Yeah.
Good now, I guess.
Even if this shakes again, we can fix it.
Okay, right.
Good?
Yep.
All right.
Cool.
This one.
Okay, so as I was saying, this combination is not something that you can imagine for long. When I was in Madrid in the PGCon in 2014, I got this question.
Why isn't Postgres working with Hadoop yet? And why are we a closed barrier to the whole ASF community? Because if you look at it, it's not only about Hadoop, it's about the whole ASF ecosystem. They have Apache Ambari and all that Hive, Pig, there are a ton of things that hang around there, and they have myriad manifestos in the sense that something is doing something on HDFS and another thing on Hadoop and blah, blah, blah. So we're all logged out of that. Traditionally, we've been a relational database, and this is something we've always been good at, right? A word of caution, the slides suck, so please don't hold that against me. So having a look, we've always been a great relational database, a standalone server. We started off as a standalone server, right? And for Postgres, something that really mattered was the quality that we maintained, right? I think most of us here are part of the developers community, so we know how hard it is to get a patch in. And there are always talks about how Tom brutally rejects your patches, and how you spend lesser time writing a patch and more time arguing it over. So that's the kind of stuff we had. But it all boils down to the quality of database that we've always maintained. Moving ahead, then over the years, we started moving towards OLAP capabilities, higher analytical functions, making reports, and recently, I'll take the credit for that. So we have the grouping sets functionality and all the queue roll-up, stuff like that. So we've always been a feature-rich database. SQL Server compliance, we've been mostly compliant. I think we are completely compliant, I'm not sure. Then we have some things which are not a part of the SQL standard, but they're good for us and for the customers we have. So we've always followed them. And there was a long-standing complaint that Upsert wasn't present. It's present now, so that even that complaint is gone. Strong transactional semantics. It's pretty hard to mess up transactions in Postgres, given the variety of isolation levels we have now. You'd really have to do something extremely stupid that we haven't thought of in order to bung up your transactions. Interactive queries. I wouldn't call Postgres a real-time system, but it's a near real-time system. And unless you're in, using Postgres in aircraft, I don't know if it's that done, you'll be good to go, You'd have a pretty good response, and the TPS is pretty high, fairly high enough to keep you happy. Relative to something like Hadoop, where you can't really do interactive queries with MapReduce, right? So yeah, that's a win for us. Now let's have a look, and this is a bit controversial. I don't want shoes thrown at me. So what is it that we're not really good at till now? Now, maybe all of this wasn't really applicable 10 years back or 15 years back. But now, given the scale of data that we work at, the how many formats of data we have around, the ad hoc queries that our data scientists want to do today, and you know, the massive shifts that we have between our data formats. We don't support a variety of data formats. On this, we have one specific data format, the on-page format that we have in 8K files or whatever size we have. That's it. There's no other way that you can store your data. Now, somebody may argue that we support a lot of other data formats that we ingest into Postgres. That's a different story altogether. That's, you take some data, you use some converters, you convert them into the native Postgres format. That's a different thing. Then you're following an entire ETL process. So what happens that, okay, let's suppose that there's a data format called X, and you know, you have SQL functions that convert from X to the native Postgres format. That's basically relational tables. So you had tons of X, you called all your functions, you converted it, stored in Postgres, nice and happy. Now tomorrow your data scientist says, hey, you know, X had an attribute, or maybe there were two attributes in X that I wanted to correlate in some other form. I need to do that now, but you don't have those attributes. Your conversion functions did not take care of that. What do you do now? Do you go back, get that X format, write a new conversion function? Yes, that's the only way. Eventually you get bored of it, and then your data scientist will say that you cannot do ad hoc queries or ad hoc experiments, right? That's the need of the hour in terms of data science. No way to bypass the SQL, ingestion in the sense, okay, I'll come to that, point three and one are correlated. No way to bypass the SQL interface. Now, here's the thing, you know, I have 10 gigabytes of data, and I really can't go to your data directory. Everybody here knows what a Postgres database looks on disk. So I can't go to data directory and create a new folder, okay, table 144 something, a random OID, dump my data into it, and I'm good to go. Postgres knows my table is there. That does not happen, right? So that prevents me from ingesting large amount of data in whatever format I have. I can't really go and do that. Even if I, you know, manually munch my X data format into the Postgres format, I can't really go and put physical files and expect Postgres to pick them up. That just does not happen. And other way around, even if I have my own weird C++ or C program which can understand the Postgres data format, I'd be really stupid to go and touch the data directly, right? So the only way is I can use the SQL interface that Postgres provides. No on-disk munching. No resource management. That's well known, well complained about, so I won't even argue it here. Everybody says there's no way I can put limitations. Okay, I can restrict the work mem, but then Postgres starts using stupid nested loop joins and stuff like that. I can't really manage resources here. Scalability, yes, because we are a process per backend server, we scale to a limit. It's not an infinite scaling system. We don't use threads, and you know, we're not a massive clustered system. There are limits to our scalability. And even for our XIDs, for example, there were 32 bits to recent times, but a colleague of mine wrote a patch, which I think got accepted, so there's 64 bits. Not sure, but yeah, we are getting there, but there's a limit. There's a ceiling which we'll hit when coming to scaling. And what I mentioned earlier, there's a whole lot of things waiting for us in the Apache Software Foundation ecosystem, which we just cannot touch. Because, you know, here's the thing, look at it as Hadoop is the entrance to a lot of things, right? It's just not Hadoop. It's a lot of things that we can leverage off. We don't need to reinvent the wheel for a lot of things. We are close to it right now. So, okay. Now Postgres moves to more of an MPP style, massively parallel processing systems. There's been a lot of great work done on the FEW sharding, the foreign data wrappers, and for us, sorted data pushed down, sort keys pushed down, and maybe one day we'll even have query plans flowing around in foreign data wrappers. But then we also have the capabilities that SGFS offers us and Hadoop offers us. So what do we do? So Pivotal did an experimental product which tried combining the two of them. We won't discuss a lot of it. I'll go over it a bit, but then we'll come to what we learned when building that product. So that product is called Hawk. You know, it's now Apache Hawk. It's been going to the Apache Software Foundation. I'll go over how Hawk is related to Postgres. So some of you might know that Pivotal did a proprietary fork of Postgres many years back, that was somewhere around 8.2, which was called GreenPlum. GreenPlum is a MPP engine, and you know, a lot of code rewrite happened. They have all those parallel query execution and parallel processes, and we have even going for planned distribution among multiple segments and blah blah blah. So Hawk was originally a fork of GreenPlum internally, and the first objective that we had was making GreenPlum work on HDFS. That was the first thing that we did, and Hawk. And okay, I don't know why it's called Hawk. Don't ask me that. Just I don't know. It just sounded cool. Okay, so this is what Hawk basically does. And now it's completely open source. You know, we'll go over how you can contribute to it. So it's like it natively works on HDFS. And there's nothing like we're using some weird connectors, or you know, we're getting data out of HDFS into the local file system and then working on it. Nothing like that. There's a library called libhdfs3, which we use, which directly talks to HDFS, and that's it. There's no middleman in between. Just an FYI, to write Hawk, we needed to add the truncate operation to HDFS. Why we need that, I'll go over it. But yeah, truncate was needed, which was added to HDFS. It's called it's in Pivotal HDFS. I don't think we open source it, or maybe we did. But that was something we needed to add. So here's what we got, right? The data processing HDFS, the scaling with HDFS, full access read and write to the Apache code. Everything in Apache became open to us suddenly. The ESF community came to our support. You know, we have a dedicated team which works on the integration of Hawk and Apache Mavi. We have some engineers who work on Yarn as well. And two of our engineers actually became Ambari committers last week due to their work in Ambari for supporting Hawk. So that's how ASF grows. And as I said, Ambari installed, we have resources managed by Yarn itself. So suddenly, we're very happy. Okay. So this is what it looks like. Something that's really cool here is the cost-based optimizer, because you know the Postgres optimizer was developed over many years by great minds. That was leveraged off by GreenPlum, which enhanced it further. And then it was used by Hawk. So now Hadoop suddenly got a system which had a great query optimizer. You know, the query optimizer actually became one of the salient features of Hawk. And people were surprised that something on Hadoop can have such a great cost optimizer. We'll go over dynamic resource allocation, which is actually done by the query optimizer itself based on the cost of the plan that has finally been executed. So that's something great. ANSI SQL, that's direct leveraged directly off Postgres, and can continue enhancing it. MATLAB is another open source project, Apache MATLAB, which was developed by Pivotal, which is basically a library of machine learning operators, which you can use to do any sort of weird KNN and clustering and stuff like that. The interesting thing here is that it works with Postgres. So I'm not sure if anybody knows here, but back in 2013, we did a project with MATLAB in Google Summer of Code. So I was the co-mentor for that, and in which a student in the Postgres community actually added some features into MATLAB. So that's the kind of correlation we always had with MATLAB, and there have been people who've been using MATLAB or with Postgres and writing functions. So MATLAB is totally applicable to Postgres, not something specific to GreenPlum or Hawk. Okay. A quick overview at the Hawk history. It was originally called GreenPlum database on HDFS because that was the only goal it had. Then it went alpha in 2012. Then we have subsequent releases, and 15 it entered the Apache incubator, and hopefully it'll be an Apache top level project soon enough.
Okay.
Yep.
So I'm confused. Which part of Hawk is Postgres? I mean, is there any
We'll go over that. So, okay, architecture. This is what it looks like. So basically, Hawk is a, you know, if you've looked at clustered MPP systems, something like XC or Excel. I love Excel. So, you have a master slave system. It's called the master and segments in this case. The master basically has the Yarn Resource Manager, the catalog service, the Hawk master, and the SGFS name node. So we already have SGFS up and running in this case, and name node is on the master of the Hawk cluster. The data nodes for SGFS run on each segment. Segments are nothing but slaves. That's a fancy term. Node manager is internal Hawk node manager, and then we have segments. Now segments basically are physical boxes. One box is equal to one segment, but then that segment can be used to process multiple queries for at the same time. So then it spawns virtual segments. So maybe the term's not correct, but imagine segment as a physical box, and it spawns multiple threads for different parallel queries. They are called segment as well. So that bit gets a bit confusing, but that's simple enough. So this part, the grayish part, was actually inherited from Postgres through Greenplum. So again, the query optimizer is a lot of, the parser analyzer are mostly Postgres. We just added to the syntactical tokenizer and stuff like that. The resource manager is specific to Greenplum, so it's not something Postgres, but yeah. Optimizer, as I said, dispatcher, catalog service, they're all specific to Greenplum, but they're there, right? So this is the main client invoking code, and this is what we do. Interconnect is again an open source alternative to the Postgres communication protocol. FEBE. Instead, we use Interconnect, which is much more stable and use state machines. We won't go over it much, but it's just there. This is what the execution looks like. Pretty standard, parser, planner. Dispatcher is an additional functionality here, because dispatcher basically dispatches your plans to the slaves. So all the planning right now happens on master, and then the master dispatches your plans to the executors, which are the slaves. A resource manager here checks if there are enough resources allowed and available to be executing this query. If they are, well enough. QEs are the slaves. All goes well. Or else, the source manager says that, okay, not able to execute this query, leave it off. Just another plan. So with the recent addition of parallelism in Postgres, we have the gather motion. This is a pretty similar gather motion in Hawk as well. Distribute and then gather result. In addition to gather, we have broadcast and redistribution, which we won't go over here because they're pretty standard non-SQL things, I think, and not relevant to our discussion. But yeah, these are three types of motions we have. Broadcast is basically sending tuples to all segments. Okay, this is something interesting. Now, what happened here was that catalogs started to become a bottleneck for Hawk, in the sense that catalogs only exist on the master. And whenever a segment needs to access something in the catalogs, it goes and talks to the master. So that sort of started becoming a problem, and with the curve, because that was never built to scale at this level. So internally, a language called CAQL was invented, which is basically internal to Hawk. If you're a client, you want to access the catalog, you still need to use SQL. But CAQL proved to be had a lot of pool caching and stuff like that, so it basically optimized your catalog management. So this is part one of what's really different from Postgres and Hawk. So imagine, I'm not saying that Postgres needs to first become a cluster system in order to move to Hadoop or SGFS. But if we do want to move to SGFS, that's something we need to look at, because catalogs really can't live on SGFS. We need to store them on a normal file system. But then how do we make sure that the normal file system does not become a bottleneck? The catalog access eventually does not prove to be a bottleneck. So this is one part of it. There's another thing called self-decorated plans that we'll go over. Virtual segments, which we discussed, there's a physical box that's called a segment. Virtual segments are the processes that are spawned by that that physical segment to execute parallel queries. Segment is pretty much stateless; it does not, maintain any state. Self-described plans. Self-described plans are pretty interesting. That's something I want to go over. So right now, if you know the Postgres query,
The
back end. The front end is mostly same.
So in front end you have enhanced some capabilities like resource allocation, which is not available in the Postgres.
Yes.
Correct?
See, you can actually go and set your resource limitations. Okay. Don't allow more than 2 GB of this to be or something like that. But from front end, not much has changed apart from some additional features that you mentioned. The core changes went into the back end to support.
So I remember this one, like open source Hadoop DB is also there. It's doing the same kind of thing that uses the front end as a file. You can query put your file of PostgreSQL by JS.
Right.
Integration between that JS and the PostgreSQL.
Impala?
Hadoop DB.
Hadoop DB, okay. That probably, I think this is more of a marriage of NTP systems with Hadoop. That's what we call it. We're not saying they're not competitors.
And just to be clear, this is not trying to be an OLTP system.
No, it's not. Okay, interconnect is the replacement for FEBE. It's more of a state machine and it uses TCP and UDP both, which provides a much better performance benefit with UDP and provides more stability with TCP. No, won't go into much. It's more of a state machine. This is what a state machine looks like. But okay, don't ask me questions about it. So yeah, okay. Transaction management, something new again. So something that proved to be a problem in Hop is the presence of 2PC and MVCC. Now, how do you actually allow multiple writers to the same table or to the same topic? And remember, HDFS is the biggest problem with HDFS is that it's an append-only system. You can add to it, you can probably truncate it with the new features, but you cannot override. So how do you manage that? So for that, and that's a problem with wall as well, right? You just keep on adding wall. And how do you, for pages, they just keep growing, right? How do you figure which, to what extent is a page valid and what part of your page needs to be truncated? Maybe a transaction did not commit, but the data was already written to the page in SGFS and you can't delete it. Or you need to truncate the entire page, which is not a great idea. So what do you do? Okay, so basically something here is called a swimming lane protocol. Swimming lane protocol basically means that, in a nutshell, it allows multiple writers to create multiple files for the same table on HDFS, and all of them write to their own files. And there's a separate table, not in HDFS, in the catalogs, which maintains the HDFS files, which are relevant to one table. So because it's an OLAP system, we don't expect a lot of transactions. OLTP, you'd have a million transactions together. This would have gone haywire. Million files for one single update, no thank you. OLAP, we don't expect that much of a load. So there are lesser transactions writing more data. That's good for us because maybe there are 5 transactions, each of them writing 10 gigabytes in one file, which is fine. The catalogs don't grow that much. Catalogs only see 5 files, and that's it. But data on HDFS is growing exponentially by each writer. So writers aren't really blocking each other. They are writing concurrently, and there's just a bit of a more catalog overhead for maintaining which files are related.
How does this handle updates then?
Updates is the standard, it's...
But if you have multiple versions of the same...
You need to update all of them so that they have the catalog, right? So catalog knows which files are relevant to each of the tables. So you need to go and write to all of them. So yeah, can that.
Architecture part is covered like a Hadoop kind of thing. You have distributed kind of stuff.
Yes, that's
so
right.
All the distribution and the query processing is done by Hadoop.
Distribution...
How will you identify which data is?
So data is on HDFS, right? So data is on HDFS. So it's been handled by Hadoop, that's fine.
Okay.
Hawk only maintains internally, not on HDFS, which files on HDFS are related to which table. So there are catalogs, right, on the master. So there's another new catalog, which basically tracks the file node IDs on HDFS and the table ID, which is known to Hawk. So we get the ID from PG class and maintain that, okay, these 5 or 6 files are for this relation ID.
Kind of a work process,
sort of, yes. You can definitely call it that.
Okay. Does it create a replica asynchronously on the site? Let's say you've got another writer.
Mm-hmm.
So how does it get the next file?
So yeah, I think that they use a standard. So we don't really mess with HDFS ways of getting files. So yeah, whatever method HDFS uses. I'm not an HDFS expert, but we'll let HDFS handle the entire file writing. Okay, so that is something that's good. And so that's called a swimming lane transaction. Each writer writes in their own swimming lane. And we just maintain which swimming lanes are related to which table. Am I out of time? Okay, resource management, another critical area for Postgres, which we don't do, we should do. Now there are two level resource management that Hawk does. One is YARN or something external, which basically gives you resources. So Hawk sits on top of YARN. Now whatever resources YARN gives you are the only resources known to Hawk. That makes Hawk pretty readily available on shared clusters and in clouds. You know, you can use commodity hardware, you can create shared clusters, you can just manage your resources allocated to Hawk itself through YARN. And then Hawk's internal resource manager, which are basically resource queues, manage available resources internally to each different query, right? So there's YARN, which allocates X amount of resources to Hawk, and then Hawk internally manages those X amount of resources for each different query. How that resource allocation is done is, again, you know, you can use resource managers, you can set your limitations. No query should use more than 2 gigabytes of, you know, I don't know, maybe work mem or memory itself or this much of CPU. You can actually set the amount of CPU percentage that is used after this query is run. So if it's at 37%, it should not exceed 50%. So it basically estimates how much, so that's basically an operator CPU usage, and you can estimate how much CPU usage will happen here. And then it's mostly a predictive system for these cases, but yeah, it does work. Hierarchical resource queues basically are the pretty standard computer science hierarchical resource queues. You know, we have aging of processes. So what happens if 5 queries cannot be executed at this point of time? They are put in the queue and then they age, and gradually when resources get available, they are pushed through. This all supports prioritization, so you can set the priority of a query, and there are some cases where you can say, okay, back off whatever number of queries you need to do, but execute this one. This is business critical. That's another way. So this is what it looks like. This is the Hawk QD. This is basically the master. Fault tolerance is something different, and this is what happens. So YARN and Mesos interact with the resource broker, which is basically the Hawk resource manager's entry point. And then we have the policy store. Okay, what query gets what kind of resources, the resource allocator, and request handler. So then the optimizer said, it's a cost-based decision, right? The optimizer interacts directly with request handler. Let's say, okay, what at the optimization level, we decide if the resources are available or not. Not at the execution level, because when we start executing, we're already on these slaves. At that point, doesn't make a lot of sense to roll back, because you've already sent the plan to your slaves, right? You already spend the resources, the network IO, whatever. Doesn't make sense. So that's what it looks like. Storage, again, they are row-oriented and column-oriented tables, and we can compress them. Basically, it was more about inventing new scan methods, access methods, and that's it, not much. PXF is basically the extension framework. Extension framework allows you to, it's basically a library of access methods. So you know, you can maybe get, so you can start reading accumulator tables in Hawk. Just get just plug in the access method into Hawk and then tell it where the accumulator tables are available. It's good to go. So that's basically a black box for Hawk. Okay, how to contribute? That's a site. It's pretty standard Apache process. There's a Jira, you can go and look at the bugs. We have newbie bugs, and there's a whole wiki on how to contribute. So the community is pretty helpful. You can definitely go and have a look. You can actually catch me outside and ask me if you have any specific questions. Okay, you can find it on the wiki. Nothing too special, pretty much like Postgres, except the Jira process. Okay, these are the things that we really want to have: indexes on top of HDFS. That's something that the community is really looking forward to. Geo replication, there's some work going around it, but yes, the more the merrier. Right? Integrate the ecosystem, that's a huge pain point for us right now. We have limited resources, and we need to integrate with the entire Apache framework. There are tons of them: Accumulo, HBase. I don't know, I can't even remember the names of them. So if you are, you know, if you work with them, or if you experience with them, please come to us, talk to us, and you know, add some access methods. A lot of integration work is happening, and that we'll be really thankful for it. And maybe you can even get to become an Apache Hawk committer. That's something good. Okay, this is all references. Now, this is something that's interesting for us as a Postgres community. What does it boil down? So suppose I wanted to make Postgres work on HDFS today. These are the two main areas that I need to look. Why? The point one, the transaction recovery, is basically because HDFS is appendable. So once you get things working in HDFS, you can get it to work with anything, because most of the Hadoop ecosystem members use HDFS as their file system. So once Postgres starts working in HDFS, we're good to go. Now, that's not something very easy right now. Off the bat, it's not something like adding 10, 15 methods and getting it to work. It's a lot of rework for transaction recovery. I doubt that it'll ever make it to the Postgres core. Tom would probably shoot the writer. So, okay. Now, what Postgres can learn from Hawk? Eventually, when foreign data wrappers start sending query plans or start acting as the connection points between shared nothing systems to build them all into one whole cluster, right? Then we will need to figure how we handle metadata, the catalog tables. Right now it's fine, they're all acting in independent systems. But once they start depending on each other in terms of catalog, we might need to look at how do we scale catalog tables. Self-describing plans are something that Hawk does to avoid that problem. So if you look at the amount of catalog access we have, when we're executing a plan, that's a time where we do a lot of catalog lookups as well. I'm not saying we don't do that during parsing or planning, but execution requires a lot of time. So what you could do is, self-describing plans, basically decorate your query plan with the needed needed catalog data. And one aspect of that is that you get to look at the visibility of that specific query plan. So you don't need to call the heap tuple satisfies MVC methods all the time to check if this tuple is visible to this user or not, or this transaction, or I'm sorry, to this transaction or not. Basically get all of that data decorated in your query plan. So your catalog accesses and your plog accesses go down drastically. So the number of times you actually go back to the master and talk to it and access data, maybe C-log or not C-log, basically visibility functions, goes down massively. And if you need to have some operator data, like some operator types, or if they're mergeable, they can be used in merge joins or not, that's pretty regular data. So that can all be gotten at plan time and added to the plan tree itself. That makes the plan tree pretty heavy. That's one downside of it. But yeah, that is something that can be done. Multiple type of tables, I think there was some work being done to support columnar tables. I'm not sure where it went, but yeah. Then Postgres is definitely moving in that direction. Compressed tables would be next, I assume. Swimming lane protocol. So if you don't do 2PC, swimming lane actually allows you to do the multiple writers, the concurrent updates thing, right? And that is something that's, if it's not impossible, it's pretty bad to do with 2PC, right? That's something we might have to look at if we want to move to HDFS. Not sure, right now we only support two isolation levels, so I'm not sure how much it'll integrate with the variety of isolation levels we have in Postgres right now, but that's a start. That is one way of looking at it, but the writing on the wall is that 2PC maybe won't support the needs of HDFS, or maybe we won't be able to exploit HDFS capabilities completely if we only stick to 2PC. Beyond what? Now, one thing is that for a file, right, you can just, in HDFS, you can just append to it. So there's a physical length of that file. But now, some records at the end of that tuple, or maybe at the starting, are not maybe applicable, or they need to be deleted. So what do? You define a logical length. Simply said, it says that only the 100 first 100 bytes of that file are valuable. Just read it there. And if there's any access beyond those 100 bytes, there's an offset, ignore it or just error out or do whatever. But do not depend on the data beyond those 100 bytes. That's the logical length of your files. And that basically is a one-time write into your catalogs or wherever you're storing that data. But that saves you a lot of pain from appending a lot of wall records. So that's one thing we should look at. Second part of it is resource management, which is, again, something that is discussed all around. Virtual cost-based dynamic resource management is secondary. We need a resource manager first. And the way Hawk does it internally is using resource queues. So if we want to move to Hadoop or HDFS, Hadoop specifically, we will need to have our own resource manager. And we could probably start off with resource queue. Resource queues are pretty simple. We define 10 slots, and you say that aggregate of those 10 slots should not exceed 5 GB of data, or 70% of CPU utilization. That's not something very, very hard to implement, but might be hard to test. But if we get that, we will have a lot of customers happy today. And if we ever decide to move to Hadoop, that will integrate very well with Yarn or Mesos, the native Hadoop resource managers. Okay, so that's mostly it. Sum it all up, the biggest two things that I feel personally need to be done if we want to move to Hadoop are the transaction management, the recovery part, the wall part, seeing how we can scale up our metadata access, the catalogs, and as a bonus, resource management. Right? If we can get resource management in place, I think that would be something really cool to start off with. And yeah, I hope somebody will come up with a pass for that. Maybe. So yeah, thank you. And if you have any questions, I'll be glad to take them.
Tables are regular tables with regular columns? Mm. Vantar, integer, columns.
Yes, they are.
How does that map to unstructured data, JSON stuff and all of that?
So we use a regular JSON parser that we have for Postgres, right? No? So you have JSONB, right? So that's the same format. You just take that and put it into HDFS format. So the only thing that's changed is that the page layout that is Postgres, right? The table headers and the kind of data that we put in through structured, and then we have the footers telling how many tuples are there. That's the only thing that's changed. Rest of it, if we can convert, if Postgres SQL or internal functions are converting JSON into its own format, it's good. We use the same to write them to HDFS.
I'm guessing you guys are not using the shared buffers for this?
No. That's something we had to work.
So you guys basically had added a new storage manager basically for HDFS?
Yes, that's right. Storage manager was the biggest part that we had to write.
Was it very difficult? I'm just curious.
It was. It was pretty difficult to get right. No, it was not difficult to write, but to get RIGST. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Sure.
So the integration is possible to pull this from how? Suppose I need to segment of tables.
Yeah, you definitely can do that. I think there was somebody writing a connector for that. And it should not be too difficult. If you treat them as two separate entities, you can probably use the connectors available. And I think there's somebody writing a form data wrapper for that. So yeah, this is definitely possible. Any other questions?
Nested loops don't make sense for this kind of data, right? So you don't support that?
We do, but that's only if you're very unlucky. But they don't make us any sort of sense. And if we actually say that if you see a nested loop join happening, you should contact us and let us know. We'll see what's going wrong.
No, I mean joins in general.
Joins in general, yes. That's the same problem as Hadoop, right? Joins don't make sense in Hadoop.
Right.
But since Hawk essentially still is a relational system, we need to support joins. So we do them through spawning multiple workers and stuff like that. But yes, they don't make a lot of sense at this stage. So there are talks of making joins better in using some in-memory systems, but still in work, not something that we have really worked on.
And essentially, you took the green from parser to container plan, and then basically the storage manager is HDFS. That's what you did.
Yes. So this was originally called green plum on Hawk and HDFS. So,
what is the resource allocation? What I understand is all whatever you create is all in the backend scenario which is on the road because it's getting it up on the HDFS.
Yes. So eventually,
resource
allocation of front end, so you can set your resource limitations, right? So you as a user might not want your individual queries to exceed some set of resources. You might have 10 queries, and you want to ensure that each of them gets a fair slice, even if one of them is very heavy. So even if there's one guy, there's one elephant in the room, you don't want it to hog all the resources, but you want it to wait. So you can set your resource limitations. But that does not mean that that affects the amount of resources we get from Yarn. So Yarn resources are something that are oblique, you know, that are not something that you see as a user. What you see is the per query resource management that you set at your level. So if a Hawk gets X resources from Yarn, that's not something you can do, but you can tell Hawk how to invest those X resources in your queries.
You said one more level
yes.
up. From
that's a hierarchical.
May I present reduces the assigned from the
window. That's right. Okay, thank you guys.